Once upon a time, in a faraway land, lived a king, Stefan by name, and his lovely queen. Many years had they longed for a child, and finally their wish was granted. A daughter was born, and they called her Aurora. Yes, they named her after the dawn, for she filled their lives with sunshine. The king proclaimed a holiday throughout the land, so everyone in the kingdom might pay homage to the infant princess. From the city, from the villages and farms, came the rejoicing multitude. Across the great stone bridge and up the winding road to the castle they came. Knights in gleaming armor, standard bearers with flying colors, and the happy subjects of the king, their voices raised in joyous song. Health to the princess, wealth to the princess, long live the princess Aurora.
Hail Aurora! Hail Aurora! Joyfully now to our princess we come, bringing gifts and all good wishes too. We pledge our loyalty anew. Hail to the princess Aurora! Subjects adore her. Hail to the king, hail to the queen, hail to the princess Aurora. Health to the princess, wealth to the princess, long live the princess Aurora.
Castle, King Stefan and his queen welcomed their lifelong friend, King Hubert, who was monarch of a neighboring kingdom. Fondly had these rulers dreamed that one day their kingdoms would be united, and now today their dream showed promise of becoming true. For today they would announce that Philip, Hubert's son and heir, would be betrothed to Stefan's child, Aurora. Suddenly, a golden shaft of sunlight appeared in the room. Three sparkling balls of light floated down. The changed figures of the three good fairies, Flora, Fauna, and Merryweather. They had come to bring their gifts to the infant princess. Each of us the child may bless with a single gift, no more, no less, said Flora. Ah, little princess, my gift shall be the gift of beauty. Beauty rare, gold of sunshine in her hair, lips that shame the red, red rose. She'll walk in springtime wherever she goes. Then Flora waved her magic wand over the royal cradle. Tiny princess, said Fauna, my gift shall be the gift of song, melody her whole life long. Merryweather hovered nearby. Hers would be the last gift. Sweet princess, my gift shall be... There was a crash of sound. A mighty wind rushed through the room. A bolt of lightning split the air, and out of its flaming heart stepped the evil fairy, Maleficent. she was angry at not having been invited to the celebration, but at first pretended otherwise. To show I bear no ill will, said Maleficent, with a vengeful smile on her lips, I too shall bestow a gift on the child. Listen well, all of you. The princess shall indeed grow in grace and beauty. But before the sun sets on her 16th birthday, she shall prick her finger on the spindle of a spinning wheel and die. And when she had spoken, she disappeared in a burst of fire and smoke. Don't despair, your majesties, Flora tried to console the king and queen. Meriwether still has her gift to give. But Meriwether's powers were not strong enough to undo the full evil of Maleficent's curse. She could only change death to sleep. And from this slumber you shall wake, when true love's kiss the spell shall break. Immediately the king ordered all the spinning wheels in the kingdom to be burned. But the three good fairies knew this would not stop Maleficent. Secretly, they devised a plan, which they presented to the king and queen. They would disguise themselves as peasant women, raise the baby as a foundling child, and live in the woodcutter's cottage deep in the forest. Surely Maleficent, who never understood anything about love or kindness, would never suspect or find them there. And so it came to pass that for 16 years the princess lived safely with the three good fairies. She knew nothing of her royal heritage, nor of her rightful name. The fairies called her Briar Rose. Her only friends were the birds and the little animals of the forest. On the bright morning of Briar Rose's 16th birthday, Flora, Fauna, and Meriwether set her out to gather berries. They must make the cottage festive. They must make a birthday cake. They must make a dress befitting a princess. And they wanted to make it all a happy surprise. Then, when the sun was nearly down, they would go to the castle, and Briar Rose would assume her rightful place as Princess Aurora, daughter of the king and queen. Fauna started to make the birthday cake. Flora started to make the dress. Meriwether stood helplessly by as the dress model, while the other two fairies, who had neither cooked nor sewed, did everything completely wrong. Briar Rose had always been a happy child, but lately she was lonely. As she walked along, she called to her forest friends. The birds, the rabbits, the squirrel and the owl joined her. When they came to a good resting place, Briar Rose paused and sang a plaintive song.
Someone to sing to.
sweet things too. A gay little love melody. My heart keeps singing, will my song go winging to someone who'll find me and bring back a love song to me. If my heart keeps singing, will my song go winging to someone who'll find me and bring back a love song to me? Why do they still treat me like a child? Briar Rose then asked her little friends. They never want me to meet anyone. But I have met someone. He's tall and handsome and so romantic. Then she confessed it was only in her dreams. But they say if you dream a thing more than once, it's sure to come true. And I've seen him so many times, said the lonely princess. In another part of the forest, a young man was riding by. It was Prince Philip on his horse, Samson. Philip heard the lovely voice. What is it, Samson? He asked his horse. Let's find out. Samson was not interested. But with the promise of an extra bucket of oats and a few carrots, he broke into a gallop. Suddenly he jumped over a big log and unseated the prince, who landed with a terrible splash in the stream. The prince got soaking wet. No carrots, said the prince, as he hung up his wet cloak and hat on the limb of a tree, took off his water-filled boots, and sat down to rest while they dried. Briar Rose's friend, the little squirrel, saw the cloak and the hat and the pair of boots. Slyly, he motioned to his companions. Here was just what they needed to cheer up Briar Rose, a mock prince. The birds flew over and got the hat and cloak. The rabbits jumped into the prince's boots and brought them too. When they neared Briar Rose, they tried as best they could to look like a real prince. The owl wore the hat, the birds held up the cloak, and the rabbits hopped about in the boots. Briar Rose gasped, then quickly entered into the spirit of the fun. She curtsied prettily. Why, it's my dream, Prince. Your Highness, you know I'm really not supposed to speak to strangers, but we've met before. She started to dance, guiding the mock prince as she whirled about and singing all the while. I know you, I walked with you once upon a dream. I know you, the gleam in your eye is so familiar, a gleam, yet I know it's true that visions are seldom all they seem. But if I know you, I know what you'll do. You'll love me at once, the way you did once upon a dream. La 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 It's true that visions are seldom all they seem, but if I know you, I know what you'll do. You'll love me at once the way you did once upon a dream. Prince Philip, in search of his lost hat and coat and boots, came upon the sight of the lovely girl dancing. He was amazed at her beauty. At the first opportune moment, he took the place of the mock prince in the dance. At first, she did not notice the substitution, and then, "Oh," said Briar Rose, quite startled. "I'm awfully sorry," said the prince. "I didn't mean to frighten you." "Oh, it isn't that," said Briar Rose. "It's just that you're a stranger," smiled the prince. "But don't you remember? We've met before. You said so yourself, once upon a dream." And so they danced and sang, and they fell in love. But when the prince asked her name, Briar Rose realized that she did not know who he was either, and she started to run away. "When will I see you again?" the prince called after her. "Tomorrow?" "Oh, no. This evening." Her three dear guardians must meet him, too, at the cottage and the glen. But things had not been going well back at that cottage and the glen. Farmer's cake was a failure. Flora's dress was impossible. Merriweather decided they had had enough of this nonsense and went to get the magic wands that they had not used for all these 16 years. So Maleficent could not trace their whereabouts through their tiny sparkles. But now it seemed both necessary and safe. They closed the shutters of the windows. They locked the wooden doors. But they forgot to close the chimney flue. "Now you take care of the cake," said Flora to Fauna, "and I'll make the dress. You, Merriweather, clean the room. With our magic wands, it will be as easy as a smile." When you have a busy, busy day, here is how to turn your work to play. Here's a little recipe that can't go wrong. Just sing a smiling song. When you have a mile of floors to sweep and a pile of ironing 10 feet deep, here's a way to make the hours seem half as long. Just sing a smiling song. Turn the corners of your mouth up instead of down. Come on, friend, and just pretend to play that you're a clown. When you have a million jobs to do and you think you never will get through, pick a happy melody and hum along and sing a smiling song. When you have a million jobs to do and you think you never will get through, pick a happy melody and hum along and sing a smiling song. Each of the three good fairies waved her wand. The room was cleaned, the cake was made, and in a trice a beautiful dress was finished. "Oh, no, not pink," said Merriweather. "Make it blue." She shot a stream of magic blue sparkles at the dress. Flora liked pink and changed it back again. First it was pink and then it was blue. Back and forth the colored sparks shot from their wands and drifted up the chimney. Another scene was taking place in another castle on this 16th birthday of the princess. Maleficent angrily demanded of her goons why they had not located the princess, and found that for all the 16 years they had been searching for a baby, not considering that the child would be growing up. In cold fury, she sent her pet raven out to see if he could locate the girl before the sun would set, And the raven, flying over the forest, saw the magic sparks that floated up from the chimney below. He dropped down to investigate. In the meantime, Briar Rose hurried home to tell of the young man she had met. "This is the happiest day of my life. Everything is so wonderful. Just wait till you meet him." She did not notice the dress, or the cake, or the festive cottage. The fairies were deeply concerned. "She's in love," exclaimed Fauna. "This is terrible." "Why?" asked Briar Rose wonderingly. "After all, I'm 16. "It isn't that, dear," said Flora gently. "You're already betrothed to Prince Philip since the day you were born." And so they made it known to Briar Rose that her name was really Aurora, and she was the daughter of a king, and her royal duty must be put ahead of love. The raven, hearing this through the window, knew that at long last the Princess Aurora had been found. He flew back to tell Maleficent. At the castle of the king, all was in readiness for the return of the princess. A great feast was spread out on the banquet table. "Tonight we toast the future with something I've been saving for 16 years," said King Hubert. "The outlook is rosy. The future is bright. Our children will marry. Our kingdoms unite. Come now, the toast. Scumps!"
Scumps,
scumps, a toast to this night. The outlook is rosy, the future is bright.
Our children will marry and kingdoms unite. Scumps,
scumps,
scumps, scumps,
scumps,
a toast to the home.
One grander by far than a palace in Rome.
Let me fill up your glass, that last was all foam. Scumps,
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 scumps, to a woodcarver's guild.
I'll spare no expense, on the cradle we'll build.
And trust to the children to keep it well filled.
Scumps,
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 stumps,
stumps,
a toast to the night.
The outlook is rosy,
the future is bright.
Our children will marry and kingdoms unite. Scumps,
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 stumps,
stumps,
a toast to the home.
One grander by far than a palace in Rome.
Let me fill up your glass, that last was all foam.
Scumps,
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 to a woodcarver's guild.
I'll spare no expense, on the cradle we'll build.
And trust to the children to keep it well filled. Scumps,
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 scumps.
The voice of the herald rang through the courtyard, announcing the arrival of His Royal Highness Prince Philip. King Hubert hurried to meet his son and was shocked when Philip said he had fallen in love with a peasant girl and she was the one he would marry, not Aurora the princess. "How will I ever tell Stefan?" asked King Hubert sadly. The sun was almost ready to set when the three fairies and Aurora slipped in a back door of the castle. They went up a circular stairway to a room where they would await the end of the day. There, they gave Aurora their last gift, a crown, the symbol of her royalty. The princess looked at herself in the mirror and began to sob for her lost love. "Let her have a few moments alone," said Flora. and the three fairies stepped out into the hall. But the minute they left, the flames in the fireplace flared high. Out of them came a glowing, hypnotic ball of light. In a trance, Aurora followed the light as it floated up a magic staircase, up to a tower room, where Maleficent's magic spinning wheel gleamed in the sunset glow. Touch the spindle. Touch it, I say, ordered Maleficent from the shadows. Aurora obeyed and fell like dead to the floor. The three fairies were sad of heart when they found her. As they wept, they heard the herald cry, "The sun has set. Make ready to welcome your princess." But Flora and Fauna and Merryweather knew the princess would not appear. They decided that the kindest thing they could do would be to put the whole castle to sleep until she awakened. They waved their magic wands, sprinkling sleep dust in the air, and one by one, the king, the queen, and all their subjects fell into a deep sleep. Flora overheard King Hubert drowsily try to tell Stefan about his son and realized that it was Prince Philip who had fallen in love with Briar Rose, and he would be at the cottage that very night. Here was the true love that could awaken the sleeping princess. Quickly, the three fairies flew toward the cottage in the glen. But they were too late. Maleficent and her slaves had reached there first. Already Prince Philip had been taken to the dungeon in Maleficent's castle, high on Forbidden Mountain. "We can't go there, but we must," said the three fairies bravely. There was great revelry in Maleficent's castle in celebration of her evil triumph. Maleficent taunted the prince, who was chained helplessly in her dungeon, and told him that the peasant girl was really the Princess Aurora, now asleep in the tower of her father's castle, and there to remain for 100 years. The three good fairies slipped into the dungeon and used their magic to free the prince from his chains. Flora armed him with the enchanted shield of virtue and the mighty sword of truth. For these weapons of righteousness will triumph over evil. The ravens spread the alarm that the prince was escaping, and all evil was loosed upon him. But neither lightning bolts nor falling cliffs could stop him. Maleficent conjured a thorn wall around King Stefan's castle. The sword of truth sliced it through. Maleficent turned herself into a flame-spewing dragon. The fairy's magic wand pointed out the dragon's heart. The prince threw his sword and hit the mark. In agony of death, the dragon fell over the edge of the cliff and dissolved into the black shape of Maleficent's cape on the ground far below. Wearily the prince mounted his horse and rode toward the castle. Then, with reviving strength, he hurried up the stairs to the tower room, with Flora, Fauna, and Merryweather guiding him. He approached the sleeping princess and gently kissed her. Aurora opened her eyes and smiled. Instantly, the whole castle awakened too. King Hubert tried again to tell King Stefan that his son Philip was going to marry a... But at that moment, the trumpets blared. All eyes turned toward the grand stairway, where the prince and princess, hand in hand, were descending smilingly. The three fairies watch the tender reunion of Aurora, King Stefan, and the Queen. King Hubert was delighted with this joyful turn of events, too. Oh, we just love happy endings, sighed Fauna and Flora and Merryweather.